Do we have any amendments to our agenda? Here none? I entertain a motion to adopt the agenda by Ms. Davis, second by Dr. Knox, all in favor? Thank you. Motion passed. We don't have any, sorry, I skipped one. Nisa. Reports and information.
Good evening, Mr. President, Mr. Superintendent, and members of the board. Tonight, I'm pleased to recognize the many outstanding individuals from the Clark County School District and the surrounding community. We have some very special recognitions tonight. First off, we would like to recognize our third annual Volunteer of the Year, as well as our seventh annual Impact Award recipients. And so first, we'll start with our Volunteer of the Year, who is Pastor Stephen Day of Green Acres Baptist Church. Pastor Day, are you here? Come on up. Pastor Day was nominated for this award by Cedar Shoals High School Principal Deanne Veritek. He serves as youth pastor for Green Acres Baptist Church. And in addition to his full-time job serving youth, Pastor Day comes to Cedar Shoals High School weekly to be a hallway presence, greet students, and help support others. He talks with teachers and consistently shares with them how valuable they are to the youth of this community. His optimism and support have made a difference at the school. Additionally, he has adopted the athletes at Cedar Shoals by assisting the football team with inspirational messages, participating in practices, helping with game field preparation, providing sideline assistance during home and away games, contributing pregame meals, and providing support for team members on and off the field. Pastor Day also serves as a volunteer assistant coach with the Jaguar baseball team. Through the tremendous amount of consistent time he has provided, Pastor Stephen Day has come to be not only respected, but also adored throughout the Cedar Shoals High School community. And so, Pastor Day, we want to present you with this crystal apple, and if you will please go around and shake all of the board members' hands for the apple. Remain at their America Reads school for student teachers. enrichment, and bus transportation. Additionally, physical activities are incorporated, which provide students with a variety of both athletic and academic skills. At Fowler and Chase, a total of 60 students take part in grades 2 through 5. Doctoral and master students are staffed at both locations under the guidance of UGA professors. The PALS program has been such a resounding success that students, parents, teachers, administrative, and professors all ask how they can help this incredible program grow. So thank you so much for your consistent support of our schools and students.
Thank you.
Energy Education Week, the team taught lessons to other students and brought experts into science classes and hosted grade-level assemblies. Team members lobbied leaders to support energy education year-round, and they collected over 1,000 Energy Star pledges. And so we'd like to recognize these incredible students from Hillsman: Finn Gillen, Adam Fisher, Knox Huff, Marcus Welch, and Jackie Wright. Next, we'd like to recognize the senior level team. This team was named not only Georgia Senior Level School of the Year, but also National Senior Level Rookie School of the Year. Their project was saving energy and making an impact. Team members learned about energy and resource conservation using need resources and other experiences with the Hillsman team. They educated others during Energy Awareness Month and through promotion of the Trash Hunger campaign. The team helped with statewide conservation and collected a lot of Energy Star pledges as well. And so we'd like to recognize Jack Fisher from Clark Central and Thomas Peters from Cedar Shoals. Nominated learn about individual differences and cultures and how each of us is important and special in our own way. In addition, these instructors have guided our children through many changes. Several students in the class were visiting the United States for a short time and left mid-year. I have been thoroughly impressed by how Mrs. Boyle and Ms. Smith worked to help these students for whom English was not native, and how they helped the children form strong bonds despite communication challenges. Two of these students recently returned to their home, and my son frequently talks about how much he misses them. I am grateful that these teachers worked so hard through the transitions to give our children truly enriching experiences. During the school year, a parent of one student passed away. I am so grateful to Mrs. Boyle and Ms. Smith for providing comfort and support to the child who lost her father, and to all of the children in the class who grappled with some very grown-up questions. I have complete confidence that these amazing teachers provided the emotional guidance and classroom structure that all of the students need. Finally, Ms. Smith retired this year. She did an incredible job, and so I wanted to thank and recognize this teaching team for their very deserving recognition for their incredible contributions. Congratulations. They are helpful. Again, we want to congratulate all of these individuals for the Volunteer of the Year and Impact Award winners. If you can go out front so that we can take your pictures, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Parrish to make a few remarks about this evening's honorees. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Menez, for recognizing all of these folks, and thank you all for being here tonight for this recognition. It's evident that we have wonderful students and faculty and staff in the Clark County School District, and you're the ones that make it happen for us, and you're the ones that we do the work that we do for. So again, we congratulate all of you, and thank you for your service. At this time, you can see everyone going out to have their degree. Who are the award recipients? All of you who are here to just provide support for them, if you wish to depart at this time, it will not hurt our feelings one bit. If you'd like to stay for the entire meeting, we welcome you to do that also. But if you want to go ahead and get about other things this evening, we certainly understand that. Thank you all for coming. We'll not be meeting in July, but come back in August. We'll be here again.
Well, we do have a meeting scheduled for the 24th.
20th.
20th. Yeah, June 20th at 4 o'clock.
Over here.
What I would be interested in, if Mr. Hamill, would you be able to attend that meeting? This is on the legislative committee.
Next Tuesday?
Tuesday the 20th. June the 20th.
No, I'm going to go on a Monday.
I can talk with you later.
Anything else about that?
No.
Okay. All right. Finance Committee, we had that meeting today. Mr. Ward?
No, I don't have anything.
Okay, thank you. Policy Committee meeting, Ms. Ellis?
Encouraging all board members to attend.
All board members. This is about our board operations. So we need the voice of every board member to weigh in. So if you cannot attend, please be sure that you send me your thoughts. And happy to friend them and have them say.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. The next one is the property committee. I know there has not been a property committee meeting since our last meeting. Ms. Davis, I know you were here, as were several other board members, at the West Broad Initiative public meeting that was held. And I think part of the discussion that was a follow-up to that was for each of the entities to go back to their respective boards and then have some discussion about the information that was shared during that public meeting. So I'd say there's a need at some point in the
very near future. I didn't ask for a policy for a property committee meeting, so I'm looking for that to be scheduled.
Okay. Any other comments about any of those committees? Okay. The next item on here is the policy discussion, and you can see that this number of policies were actually discussed at the last policy committee meeting. And as Ms. Ellis just mentioned, I think most of the board members were there to have some discussion about these. So unless you all have any specific or additional questions about those, it'd be my recommendation that you post these policies for public review and comment.
Okay, recommendation from the superintendent to post these policies for general public comments. I need a motion on that. By Dr. Knox, second by Mr. Davis. Got the questions on that? All in favor?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Moving into the action items, you all received the minutes from the work session on May 4th and the regular meeting on May 11th. Be my recommendation that you approve the minutes from those two meetings as you received.
Okay, recommendation to approve the minutes for the work session and also the regular meeting. The motion on that, moved by Ms. Green, second on that, second by Ms. Davis. Okay, any questions or any further questions about these minutes? All in favor?
Thank you. You also received the April 2017 financial report. It'd be my recommendation that you approve that report as you have received.
All right, recommendation on the financial report. Need a motion on that? By Ms. Davis, second by Mr. Davis. Any further questions about the financial report? Any further questions? All in favor?
Thank you. Item number three are policies for adoption. These policies have been out, actually, I think, for 60 days. Because we did not take action on them until at the last meeting. Dr. Myers, have we received any comment about any of those?
We have not.
Okay. No comments were received. While they were posted twice as long, it was actually required. So it would be my recommendation that you approve those policies as they have been posted.
Okay. The recommendation from the superintendent to approve these policies. It was 60 days. Any motion on that? By Dr. Knox, second by Ms. Ellis. Any further questions on these policies? Go ahead.
Well, not necessarily these policies, but all policies. And when we have that opportunity for a public comment, there are some significant changes being proposed, even in the policies that we put out in item F, the board policies. And I do invite public comment. I think that it's important to take a look at how we're looking at changing our governance structure. And there are things in there like term limits, and also whether or not the president or vice president can see themselves, and the community has concerns about that, then I do invite that comment there. And as for these policies, I'm really excited to see that the professional personal ethics is being rescinded and being revised under policy GBU. So again, I invite the public to continue to comment even though we're closing these or about to adopt these.
Okay, Mr. Davis?
Yes, sir. I know I went on Monday, I think, and it may have been too soon, but I was trying to figure out how folks would make a comment. So I know I went, I don't think they were posted Monday. If they were, then I totally missed them, and I don't know how to use them.
Now, what set of policies are you
talking about? The ones that we have there for policy discussion.
Okay,
so they're not going to be posted.
No, we have to.
Oh, we're posted.
And tonight.
Okay.
And they will be posted.
So only tonight, and then they're posted. Okay, my bad.
Any further questions about that? Well, we're saying policies now, but we also have five regulations. We also go on notice. Any further questions?
Can we just get clarification on how the access fee, since that question came up? How
easy? Dr. Meyer, can you tell us that?
Certainly. And so, policies to adopt DF all through JBCCA are posted. And if you go on our website and then under Board of Education and drop down to policy manual, GSBA changed the look of this. We use their system to load our policies. So I'm glad you
what?
Next steps, BOE to policy manual to home depending policies, and then click on the link, so it's a five-click process.
You have to go to the policy manual, find where they're, because they're on the homepage of the policy manual, basically.
I don't think it's quite five clicks, because that is, I think they completely wrong.
Maybe the four?
You.
Maybe just email us, but hey.
You can, yes.
Just email your board member, that would be so easy.
Okay.
You know, now, I mean, before we move on to the subject, what, you know, I know we're still working on the website, Lisa, but what, how will that change? Let's say, for instance, take the example of looking at policies under review. How will that be different when our website is updated? Do you know?
Well, the policy manual, in order to submit feedback, is for this GSBA, which is not part of our website, we just provide a link to that website. That part of the website. But it was a different process, was for example, if we had this big issue with our code of conduct, we specifically solicited feedback over that. So that one was handled a little bit differently, just the regular monthly policies that we use.
So we actually go to the state website.
GSBA has a platform.
They have the platform. So we actually, so our policies, even though they are unique to Clark County, they are on the GSBA. So every school district, no?
No, so you can choose different software programs, basically, for lack of a better way to say it, and GSBA provides one of them, and it's probably, you can pay for it and subscribe to it. And actually, Dawn and I looked at various platforms, but that day that she and I went through all of the Bs and all of that when we were sitting down together, and we looked at a couple of different platforms, and they're all so similar. Like, they're almost indiscernibly different. They all have a bajillion codes you can pick from, and you can put the policy where you want, like, under whatever code you want to put it under. We just happen to subscribe to the GSBA platform for organizational purposes only. We did not elect to subscribe, and I don't think we should, because I think our policies are far and away better. But GSBA for small districts does provide a full-blown policy manual that's not specific to their district. A lot of tiny districts just don't have the funds for, you know, attorney review and things like that. So they may subscribe to that. We do not subscribe to that. We simply use the platform, but perhaps maybe at least so we can have a link to that a little bit more visible instead of being under Board of Education, because I don't know that I would think to look under Board of Education for that.
Even if they're not on a GSBA, like it's not quite as
we'll be able to do that. Any of these, what we can do is right now, the website that we have, we're able to really go in and look at some analytics and see sites that people are constantly visiting, and we want to make sure those are more easily accessible. And then my office also launched a survey, and we've got a lot of feedback from teachers and others about what their thoughts were to make it more user-friendly. So we have a lot of really good feedback to know how to pull out information on our site. So for example, parents will be able to find things like lunch menus and bus routes much more easily. They won't have to know that that's within district services to be able to access that information.
I'm sharing your page. When is the menu?
August 1st.
Okay, great. Thanks.
I'm sure.
Yeah, just as a point of information, I talked to you about this before. About once a week, I get a phone call from them about, you know, how I register my child. And I know it's up on the left-hand side of the website, but not everybody's seeing it, obviously.
One thing that we will have on our new website are also these icons, and they're called global icons, and these are the areas where people are frequently visiting. And registration will be one of those, like registration jobs at CCSD. So we are going to make that registration information much clearer on our new website.
And also, is the phone, I know the phone number is listed at the very bottom, along with our address. Is it going to be listed somewhere else? Because it just, you know, it's kind of almost like I think the address and phone number is really important, because kind of most websites bury it at the very bottom. So it's not just us, it's Credit Union, Bank of America, everybody wants to hide their phone number, it seems to. Now, I'm not saying we're doing it on purpose.
It'll be at the bottom, but also contact us will be much more prominent when we're translating the website. Some of these areas that we really want people to be able to easily access, we will make it more readily available.
I got one other question for you. This may not be in your wheelhouse, Lisa, but one thing that I've talked to Dr. Parrish about is, you know, how folks, when they call up, what happens, what kind of experience they have. Is that within your wheelhouse?
We have talked as an administrative team about an overall customer service initiative, and also specifically one of the items was, what is that process when someone calls us at the district office or at the school level? And we've had many conversations about that, but I'll defer to Dr. Parrish to really answer about that.
Okay.
Let me make one additional comment, because I don't know whether you heard when Dr. Myers mentioned that GSBA have changed that platform. I'm on that website looking at policies at least 3 or 4 times a week. And it used to be when you hit Board of Education, you get policies, then you go, and then our codes, I believe they go from A through M. And it used to be if you touch B, if you touch A, all of the B policies would come up. It doesn't work that way anymore. You have to scroll. It's like the question that Ms. Davis asked, if you scroll all the way to the bottom on B policies, you'll see BH and BHA, which will be the code of ethics and also the conflict of interest. But you have to scroll, but not, you can't pull them up individually anymore. Okay. All right, are we ready to move on? Okay. Any questions? All right, all in favor of the approval of these policies, I need to see your right hand, please. Thank you. All right. Okay.
Thank you. The next item are the consent agenda items. We discussed all of these some at length last Thursday, so I would ask if you have any questions about any of those items listed under the consent agenda, items 4 through 28.
Can I make a statement about this?
Yes.
Hold on a second, bro.
Oh, wait a minute.
This is consent now.
I know.
But when consent, if you have a question about one of these items only, we have to put it on.
I don't have a question about one of the items.
Okay,
I have a question
right.
About the process.
I'm just
this
trying to follow Robert's rules of order.
Should we make a motion and second it and then discuss?
If it's
not specific to this. It's a question about consent
agenda.
Okay,
let's pass the consent agenda and then I'll take your question then. Why don't we do that? Okay.
So if you don't have any questions about the consent agenda items, it would be my recommendation that you approve those items listed on your agenda, items 4 through 28.
Okay, I need a motion on that. Moved by Ms. Davis. Got a second on that, second by Dr. Knox. All in favor of the consent agenda?
Motion passed. Okay, Ms. Ellis?
Okay, so this week in the newspaper, there were two articles, I think, that were off of things on the consent agenda. One had to do with healthcare at Gaines. And there was another one, I don't remember what. But from a process standpoint, if we amend the agenda at the beginning of the regular board meeting to remove something from the consent agenda, that can still happen. So technically, just because it's on the consent agenda does not mean that it is a done deal.
Correct.
So I just, we've talked about this before, I just get nervous when I read something, it's like, Clark County School District is doing this in the newspaper, and I'm like, oh my gosh, like, that's on the consent agenda. We still haven't even, we haven't formally approved it. Just because we approved to put it on the consent agenda, there is still an opportunity to pull it off, and there is still an opportunity for it not to happen. So from a point of clarity, it just because it's on the consent agenda, media, it may not pass, but, so anyway, but thank you for the positive article, but I just got nervous when I read it. And not that I have any intention of pulling anything off usually, but just, but we have that, that could still happen. So just because it's on the consent agenda does not mean it's over.
And my observation of that would be that it was an open discussion and an open meeting that occurred last Thursday. So if someone chooses to report about that, it would be pending final board approval.
Correct. Yeah, that would be fine. Maybe that statement would help. I was like, oh gosh.
Yeah.
Let me echo what Ms. Ellis said. At the work session, we go through and we put items on the consent agenda. When we come to the regular board meeting, if it's something that you want to put off that consent agenda, let me know. We put it off and we discuss it.
Thank you.
Okay.
They weren't the consent, okay. All right, so I apologize. I was thinking the telemedical was on our consent agenda, but that was already done. That was just a superintendent's report. My apologies. I just wanted to make sure.
Okay.
I want to follow up on what Sarah just said. So if we did ever want to pull something off, the correct time, Mr. Worthy, to do that would be either amending to the agenda again, not at this point. Is that correct?
Right.
I just want to make sure we know not only that we can do it, but exactly when to do it. Don't wait.
You're correct.
Okay.
Thank you for that clarity, Anissa, and my apologies to the media.
You're okay, Ms. Ellis.
Absolutely. All right, two of the other, the next item on here actually were items for which we did not have specific information at last Thursday's work session, but were items that we wanted to ask you to take action on. So we did send you information about those at the beginning of this week so that you would have an opportunity to review that prior to tonight's meeting and not having seen it for the first time when you arrived here tonight. So the first item under there, item number 29, are geotechnical engineering services for the middle school projects that are taking place. And you can see that information is provided, was provided for you. And the cost for that is $17,990. And that's for all three of the middle school sites where there will be renovation work going on, which will be at Hillsman, Coyle, and Bernie Harris Lyons Middle School. So I would ask first if you have any questions about that, since we had not discussed it prior to tonight, but you did receive the information.
Dr. I had a couple of questions. Just looking at the forms for the geotechnical engineering services bid, am I reading correctly where the little boxes where the X's are, or things that haven't come through yet? But they're not check marks.
So can you tell us that?
Boxes. Checks. X's.
Yes. He's looking on the bid tabulation form.
Yeah, exactly.
I guess those did not come through at the time. The W-9 typically doesn't until it's awarded as well as immigration.
That's what I thought. So I just want to make sure I know what I'm reading. And the other thing is kind of more of a frivolous note, but one of the bids actually came in at $118,000, 10 times, 8 times the other bids.
Yeah.
Oh my. They deserve some kind of award for the high bid they'd be prized, right?
That's not the one we're recommending.
No, no, no. I just looked at it and I blinked and I thought I was, you know, I had to turn it and decide that I was actually seeing things correctly. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions, Mr. Grayson? Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Martin. Hearing no other questions, it'd be my recommendation that you approve the contract award for geotechnical engineering services for the middle school projects, Hillsman, Coyle, and Bernie Harris Lyons, to geohydro engineering for a total cost of $17,990. Funding for these services is from SPOS 5 account for each of the designated middle schools.
Okay, recommendation from the superintendent for approval of the geotechnical engineering for three middle schools. That's Hillsman, Coyle, and also Bernie Harris at the tune of $17,990. Need a motion on that. Moved by Dr. Knox, and second from Mr. Davis. We've already had questions, so. All in favor? Okay, all right. Motion passed.
Thank you. The next item is exactly the same, where we did not have that information to you for last Thursday's work session, but knew that it was something that needed to have board action before your next regularly scheduled board meeting. So this was the food bid for the school nutrition department. And again, that information was sent to you earlier this week, so I would ask if you have any questions about that food bid.
Let me do the motion first.
Okay, then it'd be my recommendation that you approve the award of the school nutrition food contract for the 2017-18 school year to the lowest responsive and responsible bidders, which are U.S. Food Service and Samples Institutional Foods. Funding for the FY 2018 school nutrition budget will provide pay for these services.
Okay, the recommendation from the superintendent on the food bid for school nutrition. You've heard those vendors there. I need a motion. By Davis, second by Mr. Davis. Now, questions? Any questions from board members about this recommendation? Any questions? All in favor? Thank you.
Thank you. The next item is one that we did talk about last Thursday, and you asked that we take it off the agenda. And as we discussed last week, as we're doing a technology replacement, and that means we have some surplus technology. And the first thing that we need to do in order to be able to dispose of the additional or the surplus equipment is for you to consider these or to deem these as surplus items. What we also discussed last week is that that's just the first step in the process of declaring them surplus property, because based on our discussion, we also thought that we would need to come back with you about some options that we might have for how to go about disposing of those pieces of technology equipment. So it'd be my recommendation at this time that you declare the listed technology equipment no longer needed for the district's educational purposes and declare them surplus. And then the next step in that, unlike the actual item that's on the agenda, is that we will bring back to you at a different meeting the manner in which we would go about disposing of those pieces of equipment. Is that your understanding, Mr. Gilbert?
That is, and I've had some communication in the last week with Charlie Coyle of Free IT Athens to see if we might be able to connect. So we've swapped emails four or five places.
So his recommendation is simply to declare items as surplus property.
Okay, recommendation from the superintendent is to declare surplus technology that is no longer needed in the school district. Okay, I need a motion on that. Moved by Ms. Williams, second by Dr. Knox. Any further questions on this? Okay.
Yes, I wanted to, it's my understanding that what Dr. Parrish has said is kind of a ladies, gentlemen agreement. That's not something that really, it's not part of the actual what we're voting on. It's just the understanding that's what we would do after we do a surplus.
I would consider it more than a ladies and gentlemen agreement. The recommendation is you simply declare it as surplus,
right,
and that we bring back to you a recommendation, the second part of that recommendation, at a later board meeting about how we would dispose of that surplus property.
The reason I'm asking is that the impression I got, I don't know who said it, but I thought someone was saying that once something is surplus,
say that at the meeting, because that is what our policy says.
But this motion says.
But this motion is simply to declare a surplus.
Right. Well, it's just something I might raise to our chairperson of the policy meeting, that maybe that would be one policy that we would like to look at. So maybe just incorporate, if it's X number of dollars, maybe there is a, by policy, a two-step process.
Sure.
So, thank you, sir.
Okay, any further questions on the, go ahead.
I wanted to take advantage since we have our friend up there. So is that, I mean, does it look promising in terms of, because, I mean, we've done it twice before, and at least once before, I don't know.
Once
before. And so the second time that we took surplus computers and cleaned them up and gave parents the opportunity to pay a low cost and go into training to learn how to use them and that type of thing, we did the cleaning up. Is that right? Because I know I went to one training in 2014 that was done by the district.
We did some, and it's the first time it was for EIT, I think.
Right.
I remember the second time it was us.
Okay, that's what I thought. Because I was involved in the first time. So.
Okay, any further questions? Okay, all in favor of item 31, surplus technology? I'm sorry.
I'm voting.
Okay. That's what we thought. All in favor?
The next, yes, sir. The next item on your agenda is district insurance proposals. We heard a presentation about this. It was a comprehensive presentation last Thursday. So it'd be my recommendation to approve the proposed premiums that were provided to you with the Georgia School Boards Association Workers' Compensation Fund and Risk Management Fund for the period of July 1, 2017 through June 30, 2018. Funding is through the FY 2018 Safety and Energy Budget.
Okay, a recommendation from the superintendent on district insurance proposal, and this is from GSBA, presentation last week, and that's for about July 1st, 2017 through June 30th, 2018.
Right.
Need a motion on that. Moved by Ms. Davis, seconded by Mr. Davis. Okay, any questions?
Yeah, just a comment. Al Sherling's speaking on all that was very late in our work session, and I felt like it probably didn't get the attention it deserves, so I would like us to make kind of a mental note to come back to that in a year or so, because it seemed like he had important things to say, and I think some of us were just kind of ready to go home at that point.
How frequently is that? Are those services actually bid?
It's every 3 years, but we do bring the premium back every year.
I just think we should listen to his expertise. It seemed really good, and I wasn't in a state of mind where I was really, you know, getting through.
Okay, any further questions?
I thought I heard him make a statement about us looking into being self-insured, and I am not comfortable that I got enough information out of that conversation to know which direction we should take, if it's something we should be looking at down the road. Where are we on that? So,
I can tell you for this year, the dollars were very, very close between Mr. Sherling's estimate of self-insurance and the dollar-for-dollar coverage from GSBA. So it really didn't make any sense because there was a much greater risk. He had based that on $400,000 potential claims. So he would suggest, I think, in the long run, we continue to do that, to look at it each time. And we've already applied through the State Board of Workers' Compensation to get approval. We're right at the end of that process. So we'll be ready if at any time it makes financial sense for us.
So that's the point that he was making, that we should be ready, we should fit ourselves in that process to allow us to pull that trigger if it arises.
Right, and we didn't know until Mr. Sherling gave us the numbers how close it was. I think it was about $25,000 apart. So it was certainly his and our recommendation that we go with first dollar coverage.
further questions? Hearing none, all in favor? Thanks.
Thank you. Yes, sir. The next item is to request that you retire to executive session for the discussion of personnel matters. And just so anyone knows, there will be recommendations for board action after the executive session.
Okay, I need a motion to go.
Okay, and the potential purpose of land acquisition, property acquisition.
Okay. Two.
Yes, sir.
Need a motion to go into executive session. Moved by Mr. Davis, second by Mr. Davis, raise your right hand, please. Thank you. Motion passed. Okay, I need a motion to go back to the regular session. Moved by Mr. Davis, got a second on that, second by Mr. Davis, all in favor?
Thank you.
All right, Dr. Parrish?
Yes, sir, thank you.
Yeah, sit down.
I'm right here.
No, take down what happened here.
Oh.
You got a motion by Amy Stoney, you got a motion by Mr. Davis, a second by Mr. Davis, and you then let's go over there. Up here, Dr. Parrish?
Aye. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you all very much for your patience. Just so you know, the reason we had to have an executive session prior to making the personnel recommendations is because we were working on a very, very tight timeline. Also, in trying to get some of the principal recommendations made. And the board does not have a regular meeting in July, so again, thank you all for your patience for being here. The last item on the agenda is personnel recommendations. You all received personnel recommendations in your packets prior to tonight's meeting. And the other items as far as personnel are making some recommendations for principals for our schools where we have vacancies for the 2017-18 school year. The names of those individuals that are recommended to you for Gaines Elementary, Dr. Robert Ezekiel, for Whit Davis Elementary, Ms. Denisha Sanders, for Boyle Middle School, Dr. Tomas Ramirez, for Bernie Harris Lyons Middle School, Dr. McKeeva Clark. Also to make the assignment of Ms. Katrina Daniel as interim director of Classic City High School. And the other item on your agenda is the resignation of interim superintendent Jack Parrish, which happens to be me, with an effective date of July 9th, 2017.
Okay, a recommendation from the superintendent with the personnel recommendation from your packet that you received on Tuesday. And also the addendum that he read a few minutes ago. I won't go through that again. He recommended four principalships. He's also interim director for Classic City, Ms. Katrina Daniel, and also his resignation effective July the 9th. I need a motion. Moved by Mr. Davis, seconded by